Friends, in our bid to keep all the sportspersons occupied and involved during this pandemic time, we from the Sports Council of Manipal Academy of Higher Education had started an initiative of organizing a series of informative, interactive webinar sessions by reputed faculty. And as a part of this endeavor of the Sports Council, today we will be having a session on first aid for out-of-hospital emergencies, which will be a very relevant topic for all sports-related athletes and persons. So I request all of you to please take part and benefit from this session. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. We have with us today the faculties from Manipal College of Nursing, Mahe, Manipal, as resource persons for the session on first aid for sports persons out of hospital emergencies, a practical touch. Dr. Melita Shalini will take us through the session with few demonstrations assisted by Mrs. Sweetie J. Fernandez, Assistant Professor, Senior Scale, Manipal College of Nursing, Manipal. So let me introduce the speaker for today. Dr. Melita has a MSc Nursing degree in Cardiovascular and Thoracic Nursing Specialty from Manipal College of Nursing, Manipal. And she has a doctorate degree in nursing as well. With 14 years of experience in teaching undergraduate and postgraduate nursing students, she has many papers, I think it's 28 national and international publications. She's currently guiding a student for a PhD project. She's also a proud recipient of TMA Pi Gold Medal for the best indexed publications for the year 2019 from MCON Mahe. Dr. Melita is actively involved as an instructor for the basic life support programs conducted at Manipal Academy of Higher Education. She also functions as an internal quality auditor for IMS at the institutional level. She has authored a book on ECG monitoring and interpretation manual for nurses. She has conducted many sessions on first aid for the students of KMC and MMC Manipal, as well as the anti-Naxal group and the students of Government Polytechnic College in and around Udupi district. Currently working as assistant professor selection grade in the Department of Medical Surgical Nursing, Manipal College of Nursing, Mahe, Manipal, she is also a sports advisor for a college. With this brief introduction, I present before you Dr. Melita. Over to you, ma'am.
Saving someone's life is divine. Good morning, everyone. So today we are here to discuss the first aid measures for some of the sports related injuries. So now to begin with, what is first aid? First aid is the assistance or treatment given to a person for any injury or sudden illness before the arrival of an ambulance or qualified medical expert. So it may require to improvise the facilities which are available in hand. What are the goals of first aid? So there are three main goals of first aid, which are to preserve life, to prevent further injury, and to promote recovery. What is the scope of first aid? The scope of first aid goes like the time, people, and place. So that means it can happen anywhere, it can happen to any person, and then it can happen at any time. Now, who can give first aid? First aid can be given by anyone who has the elementary knowledge and understanding of the human body systems and who has the specific skills which are developed on the basis of scientific principles. And the most important thing is that the first aider need to have appropriate attitude and the abilities to handle any emergency healthcare situations. Now, in sports related injuries, when we say that when the sports events are happening, of course, we can have a first aid kit available there. So the first aid kit can have few of the items, like the most important ones, we have to have the antiseptic solutions, we have to have the bandages, we have to have the cotton applicators, and then the scissors, plasters, and the band-aids, and the triangular bandage. So these are some of the very common things which should be available in a first aid kit ready in a sports ground. When we talk about the sports related injuries, these injuries can happen in the sports ground, and then when the sports events are happening, so we have to have the readily available first aid kit. The first aid kit should have some of the necessary items like the splints and the triangular bandage, the gauze bandages, and then band-aid and some of the antiseptic solutions which are required, like the Savlon and hydrogen peroxide, as well as the scissor and the plaster. Now, what are the qualities of an effective first aider? The qualities of an effective first aider, we can say in terms of the each letters which are mentioned in a word, first aid. In that, the F refers to the fast movement or the dexterity. The first aider needs to be quick in carrying out the first aid measures. And I refers to the intelligence. Intelligence here is the practical skill. And R refers to the readiness to act. The person who is giving the first aid need to be ready to act in that emergency situation. And S refers to the self-confidence. The most important thing, the one who is giving the first aid need to have the self-confidence in oneself. And T refers to tactfulness. Tactfulness is like the person needs to be very alert. What has to be done next? What is that something which is most important in that situation? And A refers to alertness. Alertness here is like which is that priority thing which I have to take care immediately. And I is integrity. Integrity is what I speak and what I do. There should be connectivity. And the D refers to the decision making ability. How quick I have to take the decisions in that emergency situations. So each of the letters mentioned in the word first aid talks about the qualities of an effective first aider. Now let's move on to some of the sports related injuries and the first aid measures which are required in those cases. The first thing is the sprain, the most common sports related injury. Now what is sprain? Sprain is an injury which occurs at a joint when the ligaments and the tissues around the particular joint are suddenly wrenched or torn. These ligaments are the structures which supports bone to bone or the cartilages. So when these are torn out, so the person will have a condition called as sprain. Now what are the signs and symptoms of sprain? The person will immediately have pain at that joint and tenderness around the joint. Now when I say pain and tenderness, so these two are different terms, and pain is something which is very subjective. The person say that I have pain, yeah, it's very subjective. Whereas tenderness, unless I touch the area which is affected, the person may not be able to tell me that the person has pain. So that the area which has got sprained will have pain as well as tenderness around the joint, increased by movement. That means that I try to move my joint and the pain increases. And the next symptom is that the swelling around the joint. Immediately I can see that joint getting swollen, followed by bruising. Bruising when I say that the area gets discolored with the blood getting collected, okay, with the capillaries which are bleeding beneath the wound. Now, what are the first aid measures for sprain? So this can be very well explained with the term RICE. Now, what is this RICE? R-I-C-E. There are four letters here. Each of these letters has got a meaning there. R refers to rest. That means I need to keep the limb which is affected in a resting position so that the further injury can be minimized. As I said in the beginning itself, the first one of the main goal is to prevent injury. So I need to see that as a first aider, I will not cause further injury to the affected area. I refers to ice. That means we have to apply ice to that area. Now, the most important thing here when we apply ice is that the ice should not be applied directly. Something very important which we need to note here is that ice cubes have to be covered in a cloth pieces which should not come in direct contact with the skin. The reason is that the person may feel chilled when we keep the ice directly at the injured area. Now, how does the ice help? Ice will cause cold sensation. As well as initially there may be burning sensation the person will be experiencing, then it may cause some kind of ache or pain at the area of injury, and slowly it causes numbness at that area. So that means the ice application definitely helps in minimizing the pain and then easing the discomfort of a person. And the C refers to compression. So compression here is that, so we need to apply compression bandages, so which can be very well performed by applying a crepe bandage at the site of injury. Now, the ice and compression, both these together will help in minimizing the bleeding, minimizing the swelling, as well as minimizing the pain. Now, how much time we need to apply ice? Ice should be applied at least for the first 24 hours or 48 hours. So, we need to apply ice for half an hour or at least 20 to 30 minutes, and there should be a break, and then again it has to be applied again. So likewise, the ice application has to be continued for the injured site for at least for 2 to 3 days. Then compression, the crepe bandage when we apply to the injured area, it has to be applied again for 2 to 3 hours a day. In a day, 2 to 3 hours, and night time it has to be released. And the fourth important thing here is the elevation. So we need to keep the limb elevated so that the swelling can be minimized. So these are the four important measures which we have to do when we give first aid for sprains. So with this, if the symptoms doesn't subside, the person can seek the medical help. Or in between, the within a day, person feels that the area is numbed and there is no sensation, or the person is not able to move at all. So then in such cases, the individual needs to seek medical help. Another most important point here is that when the person is trying to walk, the person should not bear weight on that injured area. So this can be done by using crutches or any other assistive devices. And what I said till now is the sprain which occurs at the ankle joint. The sprain can occur at any joint, like, you know, the wrist joint or elbow joint or the ankle joint. But in sports injuries, what we see most commonly is the sprain happening at the ankle joint. Now, I said about the compression. So compression can be done by applying crepe bandages. So there are different ways how we can apply the bandages, which I will be demonstrating now. Now I will be demonstrating different kinds of bandages. I have my colleague Mrs. Viti here, so I will be demonstrating on her the spiral bandage first. So imagine there is a sprain here at the wrist joint. So how to immobilize this joint? Okay. We can use a splint here before we apply the bandage. So this is a splint. So this is already soft padded. So we need not be keeping any more soft materials in between. So what I do here is that I keep a splint here so that her palm as well as the forearm is supported. Then I will be applying the bandage. Now for this we would require, if the person she herself can support on the other end, yes, that's fine, like how Sweetie is doing. Otherwise, I can take help of one more person. And the most important thing, let me just show you how to hold the bandage. Yeah. So holding bandage, always we should be holding it this way. We should never hold the bandage this way. This is a wrong method of holding. So we have to hold it this way. Now her forearm is splinted. Now what I do is, except the thumb, okay, I will start rolling the bandage from here. Along with the splint, take one roll and one more. Okay, so this is a spiral bandage what I am demonstrating. Leave the thumb out free and then move up. Okay, move up with each layer overlapping one another. Okay, move up with each layer overlapping one another, and at the same time see that there is equal width between each layer. Okay, so there is equal width between each layers. So now the forearm is supported with a splint, and then this is a spiral bandage which secure the injured limb. So at the end of this bandaging, so this end I can clip it with this clip which is available in the along with the crepe box, or else I can even use plaster as well. Yeah, this is how it will be. So this may not be that secure, so we can use adhesive plaster. So this is how the spiral bandage will be. So what I have done here is that I have started from here, okay, leaving the thumb free, and then I have rolled the bandage, okay, and see that, you know, each layer will have a equal width in between. So this is what is a spiral bandage. So this will help in immobilizing the injured wrist. So now I will be demonstrating how to apply the spiral bandage. Now imagine that Sweetie has a sprain here at the wrist joint. So what I did here is that I have placed a splint. So this splint is already soft padded, so I need not be putting anything soft in between again. Okay, if it is not soft padded, then we have to use a soft pad or a cotton piece. Okay, thick layer of cotton piece has to be used. Now while applying bandage, yeah, we have to see that, you know, the bandages are always held this way. Okay, so this should never be held like this. When I use it this way, I can roll it easily. Okay, so what I do here is that this is to support the wrist joint. So I start from here, okay, along with the splint, take the first roll and then one more. Okay, leave out the thumb free. After the two rolls, move up and then start rolling, okay, but while rolling, taking the each roll, see that the width between the each layers are equal. Okay, and this should be tight enough. And the most important thing is that look at the person's face and then try to keep communicating with the person to see whether the bandaging which I am applying is tight or not. Is it too tight? Is it comfortable for you? Okay, yeah, fine. So we should also see that the bandaging which I am applying, so or which we are applying, is not too tight. Okay, so that it should not cause any problems with the circulation to that particular limb. Okay, so this is how we can immobilize the wrist joint. And once, okay, the bandaging is completed, now what I can do is I can fix that end of this bandage with the help of a clip or with the help of a plaster. Okay, so that this way it will be secured. Now it's not fitting properly, so we can use the adhesive plasters to fix it properly. While removing the bandage also, we have to be removing it systematically. Okay, so we have to roll it back and remove it this way instead of just, you know, rolling it and removing it all at once. Okay, so when I am rolling it back again, I have to see that, you know, I will stretch this as much as possible and then I will roll it. So this is how we remove the bandage. One more kind of bandaging. So what you saw just now is the spiral bandage. So this is reverse spiral, which I'll be demonstrating. Again, this is to immobilize the wrist. So I'll not be using the splint again. So we know that we have to use a splint here and then apply the bandage. So I'll be showing how to apply the reverse spiral bandage. Now, what's the difference between reverse spiral and the spiral? So the reverse spiral will be better, most comfortable, you know, in terms of the grip. So comparing to the spiral, so we can go for either spiral or reverse spiral. But we feel that, you know, so this is more comfortable. So take the roll from down here, covering four fingers. After 2-3 rolls, take the layer up. Leave the thumb free. So now onwards, I have to twist this roller bandage. Yeah, what I did is after taking the roll here, when it comes up, twist it. Twist it and see that, you know, the center comes in the same line, and on either side we will have the same width between the layers. I will be showing it towards the end once the bandage is completed, so how it looks like. So on either side I should see that the width between the layers are same, and then that point, the center, you know, the where the two rolls are intersecting, or two layers of the rolls are intersecting, so that has to be in the same line, and then width of the layers on either side should be equal. So this is what is reverse spiral, and at the end we can secure it here. So you can see here, you know, so this is all the centers have come in a same line, okay, where I have, you know, twisted the roll. Okay, so the layers have intersected here and that has come in the same alignment, and on either side the width between the layers are equal. So why I'm talking about this equal width and all that is because one thing is that it gives a good look, and other thing is that it applies, it gives even pressure at every place, so that one place will not be getting compressed much. So that's the reason I said we need to keep communicating and ask whether it is too tight or are you comfortable. Yeah, so this is how we apply the reverse spiral. So this kind of bandages even can be applied to the lower leg as well as to the ankle joint. For splinting, if the crepe bandages are not available, we can even use this gauze bandages. So let me show you one more kind of bandaging. So this is called as figure of eight. So this will be usually applied to the joints. And now I'll be showing how to apply the figure of eight bandage to the elbow joint. Okay. So now imagine that she has a sprain here at the elbow, or she has some problem here, and where she is not able to straighten her elbow. So I should not be trying to keep her elbow straight. Okay, keep as how she is comfortable, and then maybe one more person would be required to support her limb if she is really having severe pain. Okay. So what I do here is that I am holding the bandage this way, and I start the roll from here, very near to the elbow joint. Okay, from below, one roll and take one more so that it will be secure. Then take it up, leave the elbow joint free. Okay, leave the elbow joint free, then come down. Okay, so now onwards I will be taking the layers upward here, and then when it comes down, take the layer down. Okay, here you go up, and when you come down, you take the layer down. But each roll when you take, see that the width is equal. Okay, so now what I did here is that the joint is free, and then the layers have come down here, and as we move up, the layers have to be going up and up, but the width between the each layers I should make sure that it is equal. Okay, so this is what is figure of eight. Now I secure the bandage here, and with the in this state I can even apply the sling. Okay, so let me just show you that, so that the elbow is immobilized here. You are comfortable with this, right? I can apply a sling over this so that her elbow will be well supported. So this is a ready-made sling. Okay, ready-made sling. So what I do here is that her hand will be inserted in this. Okay, and then there is a strap here which will be brought from behind the neck, and then this limb will be as much as she can bend it. Okay, in that position you keep it and then secure it here. And it can be even pinned here, or it can be even plastered here, so that the limb is well supported. Okay, it is immobile, the joint is immobilized, and then the entire hand is immobilized, including the shoulder. So this is what is sling, and then how we can immobilize the elbow joint and the upper limb, how it can be immobilized. If we don't have a ready-made sling, what we can do is we can take a piece of cloth and fold it into a triangular shape. Okay. So now it's in a triangular shape, and this is the narrow end and this is the broad end. So what I do is I will insert her hand into this. Okay, so the narrow end will come here at the elbow joint, and then one end of this will be here, and other end will be brought from this side, and here I will be putting a knot, and this is how her hand will be secured. And this part I can fold it and then plaster it here, or it can be plastered here behind so that it looks good. It gives a neat appearance. So this is how, with the available piece of cloth, we can make a sling. Now imagine that she has a sprain here at the ankle joint, and I'll be going with the reverse spiral bandaging to immobilize this joint. The limb is supported over a chair. If there is one more person to support the limb, also would be fine, so that the person need not strain that injured part. Yeah, then leave the heel area free, and then again continue with the reverse spiral. Yeah, you are comfortable, right?
Yes.
So this is how we go, and then we fix the end here with a plaster, and this should give a neat appearance this way, reverse spiral, all in same line, both ends the layer width is equal. Now we shall see the first aid measures for dislocation and fractures. So before that we shall see what is dislocation and what is fracture. Okay. So first to talk about dislocation. So dislocation is also a most common sports related injury. Dislocation is nothing but the displacement of one or more bones at a joint. Now what are the signs and symptoms of dislocation? The dislocated joint will have severe pain and the individual will not be able to move the affected part, and the injured part looks deformed. Also, you can see the swelling and bruising at the site of dislocation. Now, what to do in case there is dislocation? The most commonly here, what happens here is in sports related injuries is the dislocation of the shoulder, which can happen. Okay. So what we can do if there is a dislocation of the shoulder? So immediately you make the person sit down in a comfortable position and support the injured part, okay, in a most comfortable position. So whichever is the comfortable position for that person at that time. So we have to make the person be positioned at that position and then support the injured part. Now when I say support the injured part, how to support the injured part? So the injured part, that is the shoulder here, which can be supported by applying the sling. Okay. So once the sling is applied, so we have to make arrangement for immediately shifting the person to the hospital for further investigations. So to see, when I say the further investigations, to see whether exactly whether there is a fracture or is it just a dislocation which can be managed self. Now I'll be demonstrating on how to apply slings, because we may have a ready-made sling sometimes. Yes, especially as I said in the beginning, in the sports ground we are well prepared for it, so we may have the slings available, but otherwise maybe when we are playing or somewhere else it happens, we may not have the ready-made sling. So we should be able to improvise something which is available with us. So that improvising in the sense, we can if we have a towel or something, so which we can fold it into a triangular shape and that can be made used as a sling. So which I'll be demonstrating here and showing how to make use of the available towel or a piece of cloth as a sling. So as you see in this picture, the shoulder can be splinted by with the help of a towel. So the injured area is supported with that cloth piece, and then one end of the cloth is brought over the forearm and the other end is brought under the armpit, and then both the ends are tied around the neck. So this is how the dislocated shoulder can be splinted using a towel. And when we have feel that, you know, the lower forearm, so if there is sprain happened at the same, along with the dislocation of the shoulder, the sprain is also there at the wrist joint. So then both together it can be managed. You can use a padded cloth or something which is available, which is soft in nature, and then that can be wrapped around the forearm, and then so and it has to be tied around the forearm. So that soft cloth whichever you are using, which has to be tied around the forearm, and then this arm can be supported with a sling. So this is how, so both will be taken care, the forearm as well as the dislocated shoulder. Yeah, so this is all about dislocation, and then how can we give first aid? What are the first aid measures we can provide in case of dislocation of a shoulder or a wrist joint? Now we have seen what is dislocation and what are the first aid measures to be provided when there is dislocation of the shoulder, as well as how to support a dislocated shoulder and a sprained forearm together. Now moving on to another sports related injury, so that is fracture. What is fracture? Fracture is a break in the continuity of a bone, and it may be caused by either direct or indirect force. Now there are two kinds of fractures. One is open fracture and other one is closed fracture. In closed fracture, we will not see the open cut wound there, but the bone would have got fractured inside, which is not visible out, and there is no open wound there. And in open fracture, you can see the fractured bone has protruded out, and then there is a wound at the site of fracture which is bleeding. Now what are the signs and symptoms of fracture in general? The fractured site will have severe pain and the person will not be able to move the part, and there will be tenderness, swelling and later bruising of the injured part, deformity at the site of fracture. The most important, so this is how we can make sure whether it is just a dislocation or a fracture. So the fractured site looks deformed. Okay, as you see in this picture, so the fracture site is, the wrist joint is looking very deformed. So which itself is an indication that there is internal fracture. Deformity at the site of fracture and crepitus. Crepitus means the fractured two fragments are rubbing together, and that makes some kind of sound, so which is called as crepitus. And signs and symptoms of shock in case of fracture of the thigh bone or the pelvis. So in case there is fracture of the thigh bone or a pelvis, so there are major arteries and the veins running. So if that bleeds inside, so that can result into person going into a very fatal state, that is called as shock. And within no time, if you don't take care of a person immediately, the person may even lose the life. Now, what are the first aid measures for fracture? Now, let's see how to go about in case there is closed fracture. Now, closed fracture, if person has a closed fracture, we will not definitely know whether there is a fracture or not. But we have to assume that the site is injured, site is fractured. So, what we need to do is we have to steady that injured part and then support the fractured limb, okay, or support the affected limb. Immobilize the fractured bone by splintage. Now, splintage, when I say, I will be demonstrating this as well. And here we can use something which is hard in nature and just to support that injured part. And when we use this splint, so we have to use some soft clothes, or if there is cotton available, so we can use in between the skin as well as the splint. And then, as you see in this picture, you know, the limb has to be, you know, tied along with that splint so that the person will not be able to bend that particular leg or the extremity. So why we use this adequate padding in between the splint and the skin is to prevent rubbing, as especially this padding has to be given in between the two bony prominences. And of course, while we are shifting the person to the hospital, also we have to see that, you know, we immobilize the injured part. And while we are shifting the person to the hospital, see that the immobilized limb is being elevated above the heart level so that there will not be further bleeding as well as the swelling can be minimized. So this is for closed fracture. And as what you see here in this picture is if there is, you know, suspected fracture at the forearm or at the wrist joint, what we can do is something which is soft available, you can give it, you know, you can keep it at the palm area, and then keep the person's hand in a prone position and give a splint below, and then we have to bandage the forearm with the splint so that the wrist joint will be getting an adequate support. Now here the bandage, what you see here is a kind of spiral bandage which will be demonstrated to you. So if you suspect there is a fracture at the femur joint, so then what we can do is use two splints which are long enough. One has to be placed in between the two legs, and the other lengthy one which has to be placed on the other side of the affected limb, which has to have a length from the armpit below the ankle joint. And then both these splints with adequate padding in between will have to be strapped together so that the affected limb will be immobilized. So if we suspect that there is fracture at the knee joint, as you see here in this picture, the person is not able to straighten the knee joint. So as a first aider, we have to do is that we should not be attempting to straighten the leg. So what has to be done here is keep a splint as how the person is keeping the leg in that same position, and then immobilize the person's affected limb. Or if the person can keep the limb straight but having severe pain at the knee joint and not able to bend or not able to move, keep the leg as it is and keep a splint below, and then with adequate padding, strap that particular injured leg along with the splint. And again, here this is for a suspected fracture of the lower leg. So here we can have equal length of two wooden pieces or something which is hard in nature, and which can be kept on either side of the affected leg, and those both splints have to be strapped along with the injured leg. But when we do this splinting or immobilizing, we should keep in mind that we should not move the affected limb, whereas we can only make a movement of the splint which we are using, you know, but we should not move the affected limb. Other way of splinting, for example, I don't have anything there hard available to use as a splint. So what I can do is, if I have some blanket or some the bed sheet or something which is available right there, so which I can fold it and keep it in between the two legs, and then bring the unaffected leg towards the affected leg, and then splint both the legs together. Now what I am doing here is the unaffected leg I am using as a splint, and I have used that blanket or whatever soft material in between, acts as a soft padding in between the two legs. So if we suspect a fracture at the ankle joint, what we can do is keep something which is soft available and then cover the leg with that and then strap the ankle joint along with little portion of the lower leg and then splint and immobilize the particular area. So once we do all this splinting, so we have to immediately see that, you know, the person is transported to the hospital. So this is all about first aid for the closed fracture. Now how to go about when there is an open fracture? So here in open fracture as well, as I said, there will be an open wound, okay, and we also see the wounded area or the injured area which is deformed. So what we can do is, the first and foremost is elevate the limb because there is bleeding, we have to minimize the bleeding, and then see that the affected limb is immobilized and we have to stop bleeding. So what can be done? So we have to see whatever clean materials or clothes which are available, so that has to be used to stop bleeding by applying direct pressure over the bleeding site. And this can be done by placing a cotton pad or something which is clean, you know, clean cloth which is available, and immobilize the part. Because there is bleeding and we don't know what extent the bones have got fractured, so we have to immediately see that the arrangement is done to shift the person to the hospital. Now we'll see what are the first aid measures for wounds and bleeding. When we talk about first aid measures for wounds and bleeding, the most important two principles are to stop bleeding and to prevent infection. So our aim is to stop the bleeding, and at the same time, whatever measures we carry out there, it has to be very clean. So we can't expect something which is sterile there in the outside environment. So whatever available which are clean, because the main aim is to see that, you know, with our immediate action, whatever we do, yes, of course we try to help a person, but at the same time we should not cause any harm to the person. So these are the two very important principles we have to keep in mind. Now bleeding, when I say, the bleeding can happen due to, you know, injury to the artery or to a vein or to a capillary. So but we need to know how to identify whether it is an arterial injury or a venous injury or a capillary injury. So just to give an idea, if it is an arterial injury, so the blood will be very coming out with a high force or it will be spurting. And if it is a venous injury, the blood flow will be very steady, and if it is a capillary injury, we may see the oozing from the site of injury. So this is how we can differentiate whether it is an arterial, venous or a capillary injury. The why I am saying is that the most, you know, we need to be very, very careful if there is an arterial injury, because there can be sudden severe blood loss which can even lead the person to go into a state of shock. Now what you see here is like how to go about in case there is a wound which is bleeding. Yes, if this is happening in the sports arena, so what we can do is, if the wound is very minor, so you can clean that wound with the clean water, and then in the first aid kit, whatever antiseptic solution which is available, with that the wound can be cleaned. And of course, yeah, as I said in the principle, to prevent infection, the glove is there in the first aid kit. Wear glove and then do that, do the first aid measure, and see that the once the wound is cleaned and then the antiseptic solution is used for cleaning, ointment is applied, and keep a small gauze piece, and then apply a plaster. But if the wound is severely bleeding, you can try to clean the wound and also at the same time see, are there any foreign bodies inside the wound. If there are any foreign bodies which are very deep stuck inside, so don't attempt to remove it. So it may cause further injury to the artery or a vein and further cause bleeding. So but if it is something which can be easily removed, use the tweezers and it can be removed, or else we should not make any extra attempt to remove any foreign bodies which are stuck in the wound. And once you are very sure that, you know, there are no foreign bodies inside and it's a very superficial wound, the wound can be very well washed with the clean water and use the antiseptic solution, apply the antiseptic ointment, and then keep a clean the cotton pad there, and then apply the gauze bandage. And when the gauze bandage is applied, see that, you know, it covers at least 2 inches on either side of the wound, so that the bandaged wound will not get infected with the external environment. So once this is done, so we can again immediately shift the person to the hospital. So to tell you in a nutshell, the first aid measures for bleeding, so which can be the word bleeding, so in that you can take the first few, the 5 letters, bleed. So BLEED. So each of this refers to each of the first aid measures which can do, or the steps in a first aid measure for bleeding, what we can do. B refers to barrier, that means, as I said, wear gloves. And L refers to locate and examine, see exactly where it is bleeding. And E refers to the external direct pressure, try to apply direct pressure over the wounded area, bleeding site, and try to control the bleeding. E refers to bleeding, see that the wounded extremity is being elevated above the heart level. And D refers to dressing, okay, after once that is the wounded site is cleaned, and then apply a bandage. This is how we can easily remember the first aid measures for bleeding. Now the last part is what to do in case there is nose bleeding. Okay, so this is another common injury which can happen at the sports ground. So nose bleeding, the other term for nose bleeding is epistaxis. So for nose bleeding, there are various causes. Of course, in the sports ground, it can happen because of the heavy blow onto the nose, or the person has a fall there, so which can result into bleeding through the nose. Now what should be done at this site? Yes, of course, when someone see the bleeding, so they get panic. So as a first aider, the first aider should be very calm and should see that, you know, yeah, the person is made comfortable first. So here, ask the person to sit down and advise the person to tilt the head forward. The most important thing, you should never make the person to tilt the head backward, tilt the head forward. Okay, and ask the person to breathe through the mouth, not through the nose. Okay, breathe through the mouth and pinch the soft part of the nose. As you see here, the person is made to sit in a comfortable position, and then ask the person to tilt the head forward, and the soft area of the nose is being pinched, and person is opening the mouth and breathing through the mouth. So why this bleeding happens? When there is a forceful blow onto the nose, so the capillaries in the nose gets ruptured, and that results into bleeding. So why are we supposed to apply pressure at the soft area? Because above, if you go, there is a bony area, we may cause fracture. So with our excessive pressure, so that should not be done. And why are we making the person to tilt the head forward, not backward, is because we don't want the blood to get clotted there. Okay, and why are we making the person to bleed through the mouth is because the person's nose has been already injured. Okay, and then if the person tries to breathe through the nose, the blood which has to come out may go back and it may cause clot there. So now how long we have to apply the pressure? So applying pressure, because it may be a very discomforting for the person, because, you know, person is not able to breathe, trying to breathe through the nose. Yeah, apply pressure for about 10 minutes, then release the pressure. See whether the bleeding has stopped. If it has not stopped, again continue to apply the pressure for another 10 minutes. So usually for about 10 to 20 minutes, when the pressure has been applied, so the bleeding automatically stops. If it doesn't stop, immediately shift the person to the hospital. We should never try to insert a cotton ball or a gauze piece which is made into a ball, nothing. All that sort of things we should not try at the sports area. The person has to be shifted immediately to the hospital if the bleeding is not getting stopped with our immediate first aid measures. And the last part is that the unconsciousness. Yeah, someone who becomes unconscious in the sports ground. Okay, what has to be done? Okay, so immediately see whether the person is breathing. Okay, whether there is a pulse. Yeah, person is breathing and has pulse. This unconsciousness would have resulted in person being in the sports area for a long time under the heavy sun. So what I have to do is never attempt to give anything through the mouth, because the person is not conscious. Okay, he or she may aspirate. Make the person, or bring the person to a comfortable area, and make the person sleep on one side. So which we call it as a recovery position. As you see here, put the person to one side, see that the tongue will not fall back and cause airway obstruction. And once the person is okay, or the person has recovered, yes, and the most important thing is that avoid crowd. It usually happens in any emergency situations. People come and, you know, gather around, which they may not be of any help there, just as onlookers. So as a first aider, I should be skillful enough to see that, you know, the area is being, the crowd is being dispersed, and then, you know, the person affected is getting adequate ventilation. Okay. So if the person is still in a state of unconsciousness, even after, you know, bringing the person to a comfortable place, giving a recovery position and trying to you know, comfort the person, but there is pulse in breathing, okay, but in case the person continues to be in a same state, so we can immediately arrange for shifting the person to a hospital. Thank you very much for your patient listening. I would like to express my heartfelt thanks to the Sports Council, MAHE, as well as the Physical Education Department of KMC, MAHE. Also, I would like to express my gratitude to our Dean MCON, Dr. Anis George, for giving me an opportunity to be the resource person in this webinar. Thank you once again.
Hello everyone, I heartily welcome you all for this webinar session. During this period of COVID-19 pandemic, which is badly hit the lifestyle of students, students' day-to-day activities have gone out of track. They are made to spend their daily activities inside the four walls. As the saying goes on, idle mind is devil's workshop. As per this good old saying, many students knowingly or unknowingly have entered the world of e-games. Keeping all this in the mind, we, the Sports Council, MAHE Manipal, have come up a webinar session to make us understand on the topic psychological impact of e-games on students and strategies to handle it. I, Dr. Deepak Rambhairi, Deputy Director of Physical Education, KMC Manipal, welcome all our viewers to this webinar. I hope this session will be fruitful to you all. Please stay safe and healthy. I request Dr. Narayan Prabhu to start this session. Thank you.
Hello everyone. I'm glad to introduce Dr. Deepa Marina Rasquina, Assistant Professor in the Department of Clinical Psychology. She is also a member of Center for Studies on Healthy Aging at Manipal College of Health Professionals, Mahi. She is a specialist in the field of gerontology, that is, the study of physical aspects of aging as well as mental, social and societal implication of aging. Having a vast experience of 17 years teaching psychology at various institutes, she is a leading researcher as well with several international publications to her credit. She has headed a research project of UGC, chaired several national and international conferences, and has guided many students in their PG thesis. Currently, she has a unique project ongoing from ICSSR IMPRES on academic stress, anxiety and depression among grade 11 and 12 learners. So dear audience, this is Dr. Deepa Marina before you, who will talk on the psychological impact of e-games on students and strategies to handle it. Over to you, ma'am.
Hello students, I am here to talk about psychological impact of e-games on students and strategies to handle it. We all play online games. Even I play online games. I am not here to tell you to stop playing online games, but provided if you neglect your daily routine activities, you use it as a coping mechanism. Coping mechanisms means like when you're angry, you go for gaming. When you're sad, you go for gaming. Or when you're bored, you go for gaming. So to avoid that, getting addicted and to have a self-control, we will be talking today about the psychological impacts of these games. So let me first introduce to the positive effects of gaming. There are a lot of positive effects. To mention a few, it improves our eye-hand coordination because we continuously keep using our hands and we need to coordinate our monitor. So we use a lot of hand and also we have to have that eye-hand coordination. It improves teamwork because we play with others, other players are also in the game. So we know how to have a teamwork. It also helps us get relieved from stress. And it is, of course, a fun activity. Indian statistics shows that India is one among the top 5 countries in downloading online game apps. 68% of children of your age revealed that they prefer online games rather than having social interactions or outdoor games. The COVID-19 lockdown has boosted using engagement of this online gaming. Not only gaming, we have classes online, we have e-books, so we have a lot of things which are all online. So this can lead to a lot of physical effects. So some of the physical effects due to online gaming or being in online for a long duration are lack of physical movement. We don't move, we sit in one place. Then sight disorders. A lot of people have eye strain problems. Obesity, because we sit in front of the system and we are into online. And simultaneously, we eat a lot of junk foods. Then we have pain and numbness in our joints, especially in our fingers and hands, which is called gamer's thumb, because we tend to use a lot of our thumb while playing online games. Then there is pain in the neck and back, headaches, increased heartbeat and blood pressure, dizziness, and then we have nausea, vomiting and lack of sleep. Those were the physical symptoms or physical effects of online gaming or being in the online. We have cognitive and emotional effects. Some to name are poor concentration and attention, poor academic performance, maladaptive coping. Okay, it's not a better way. As I told you, that we go back to gaming when we are bored or when we are sad or when we get angry. Then low self-esteem, because no socialization. So low self-esteem, negative effects increase. Effects means emotion. We tend to become more angry. Angry because we don't, parents don't allow us to play games. Angry because the game that we started is crashed or destroyed by someone else. Anxiety as to when I will get to play the next game, and also getting depressed. Depressed because lost the game or I am not allowed to play the game. Then playing with strangers. Okay, in the online gaming, we play with strangers. So there are more chances of cyber bullying and harassment. And also the last emotional effect I would like to add is denial, where we deny saying that I have not overshooted my game period. Okay, or we deny saying that my academic performance has not come down. So they are the cognitive and emotional effects. Coming to behavioral symptoms. What are the behavioral symptoms? First behavioral symptom is, if we don't have self-managing control or self-control techniques, we tend to become more addictive to gaming. Then there will be decreased social relations, because we tend to play alone or we tend to play with others online, so there is no social relations. Prefer to be alone, so adjustment disorders. Always I play alone, so I want to be always alone, so I don't get adjusted with others. I start skipping homework and I become stressful. I don't write my tests. I don't involve in exams, all that. Then in online games, we are also exposed to wrong values like violence. Many games introduce us to different violence, types of violence. Then disinterest in other activities, like we don't want to have family time. We neglect our own hygiene. We don't take care of our own body. Then there is uncontrolled gaming timings. We play in the night, we play in the daytime, early morning we get up and play, late night we play. So there is no control of gaming timings. Then we hide and play. Okay, that's another behavioral symptoms where children or students or adults, anybody, it can be gamers, we try to hide and play because we are under, parents may not allow us if they know, come to know that we are playing, all that. And another main symptom, behavioral symptom is, we will be always preoccupied with games. That is, you just finished playing, next, when will I get to play the next game? So we will be always preoccupied. So these are the physical, cognitive, emotional and behavioral symptoms of gaming. Next, coming to strategies to help students with this gaming. So what are the strategies? So traditional games can be played, self-management techniques, then there is gaming detox, we have grounding techniques, then we have buddy groups or associations, and there are a lot of other activities that we can involve in. So coming to the outdoor games, I will be telling you today some of the outdoor and indoor games which can be played alone as well as which can be played as groups or as teams. So all common games, but I will be introducing you to like these games improves what of a person. Lagori, for example, all of us know to play Lagori. It improves our alertness and concentration because we need to concentrate on the pile of stones and also where we need to throw the ball. So it improves our alertness and concentration. Then we had a game, marble game called Goli Atta. Okay, attention improvement and spatial knowledge enhancement. It also, we have to pay attention, and it also helps us to know the spatial knowledge, that is how much space we need to be aware of. Okay, then there was another traditional game called Chennamane, which improves critical thinking and problem solving skills. We have hide and seek, which improves self control and also impulse control. Impulse, you know when you're caught or when you, because that's the game. You hide and somebody has to find where you are. So it improves yourself. You have to be in such a way that the person who is searching should not know where you are hiding. So it improves your self control. And we have board games that strengthen your relationship because we play with many people and we have a goal set. that our team should win. It improves our patience and it also helps in reducing stress. So I have mentioned only few. So these are some of the games which can be played as a team or as a group. We also have outdoor and indoor games which can be played alone. Okay, we have, you can see in the picture, we have another game called Marble Solitaire, which again improves our attention and spatial knowledge enhancement. Then we have Hopscotch, which is aimed at improving our analytical skills. Then we have Solitaire, that is the card game, which improves memory and concentration. You can see in the picture how the cards have to be arranged in Solitaire. Then we have Hula Hoopas, where you are aware of your body. Okay, you have to be aware of your body. It helps you build concentration. It also helps you build your self-esteem, which you saw, which reduces when we play online games. Okay, then pottery, where it improves your fine motor skills. You become more creative. And then we have solo ball tricks that improves your coordination, motor skills, and it also exercises your body. Because in online gaming, we have lack of physical movement, which can lead to obesity. So here you play alone with the ball. It can be you playing alone football, or it can be you playing alone volleyball or basketball. Okay, so that is about the indoor games. The next technique that we have is self-management techniques, which are very important. Now in self-management techniques, we have three, that is self-monitoring. So what you do in self-monitoring is, you see, you note down how much time you have taken to play the first game. So you become aware that how much time you are going to play the next game. If you fail to do self-monitoring, then it can lead to, it will lead us to lack of or track, we don't get the track of how much we are playing. Then we have self-evaluation. In self-evaluation, what we do is we evaluate, we compare ourselves with others. How much time we are spending in online gaming and how much time others are spending in online gaming. Or it can be how much time we are spending with online gaming and again how much time we are spending to socialize with others. Okay, and the last technique in self-management technique is self-reinforcement or punishment. What is the self-reinforcement or punishment? You reward yourself. Okay, you played today only for an hour, otherwise you were playing for 5 hours. Today you played for 1 hour, so you reward yourself. How you will reward? You may reward by going for a movie with friends or traveling to a place. So you reward yourself. You can punish yourself, which is called negative punishment, where we take something desirable. Negative punishment is we take something desirable. So you, for example, you set a goal that today I am going to play only for an hour, but you shoot out the time and you play for 5 hours. So you negatively punish yourself. What you do is you decide saying that, and you not only decide, but you tell that I am not going to play for the rest of the 2 days. Because that playing game was your desirable activity. So what you do in negative punishment, you remove something that is desirable. So you decide and you don't play for 2 days, because the day you told you will play for one game, you overshooted and played for 5 hours. So if we manage this, it is easy and we don't go for addiction. Okay, we don't go for addiction. The next technique is gaming detox. Now what is this gaming detox? Research has shown that if while we play, there is lot of changes happening in our brain, that is the neurotransmitters, or we tell chemicals in the brain. So research have shown that it will take up to 90 days for our brain chemistry to become normal again. If you are continuously in online gaming, our brain, we might have thought that we will avoid gaming, but our brain takes 90 days to come into normal. Okay, then parents also can help. For example, some of the tips parents can take is no e-games for preschool children. Okay, building rapport with the children. Usually parents are very aggressive or very harsh while dealing with their children. So parents can be very patient. Then problem arises when child plus video game is versus parents. So child and video game is one group, and parent is another group, the problem arises. So you need to have a good rapport and have patience as parents. Then before buying any games as parents, we need to check the age limit in the games and also the content of the game, whether it is suitable for this age group. Okay, there are many games which lead to violence, which can ask for personal data, all that. So a parent while buying game should focus on the age limit and the content of the game. Then the parents can have time restrictions to follow. For example, if the child has followed the time restrictions, give reinforcements, reward the child, give tokens, okay, and exchange the tokens for some rewards. Presently in India, there is a video game called Battlegrounds, which was actually the PUBG game, and its name now presently as Battlegrounds, but they have changed some features where in order to play that game, a parent's mobile number has to be registered. So like that, if some rules come, it will help parents also to have their impact or have their role while playing online game. Then avoid, as parents, we need to avoid e-gadgets for children during night. It should not be kept in children's room because there are chances the children hide and play. So avoid keeping any e-gadgets in the child's room at night. And motivate, as parents or coach or teachers, we need to motivate them to play outdoor games and indoor games. And finally, another main important thing a parent can do is game area. While the child is playing, see that the child playing the online game is in front of your view or in public view. Okay. The child should not hide and play. So it should be in public view, and you should, as parents, use very safe apps and search engines. The next technique to handle this online gaming is grounding techniques. So I have put there few techniques. One is called 20-20-20 rule. Okay, what is this 20-20? It's nothing to do with 20-20 cricket, but the 20-20-20 rule is 20 minutes break. You have to have 20 minutes break. You have to see something 20 feet far away, and you have to see it for 20 seconds. So have a break. Now this is not only with regard to online gaming. Now that I told you again in the beginning that we are into online mode of learning, teaching, all that. So have a break after 20 minutes, see something 20 feet far away and for 20 seconds. Then we have 5-4-3-2-1 method. What is this 5-4-3-2-1 method? So you move out, you see 5 things, you smell 4 things, okay, you hear 3 things, or you 2 things you touch or you feel, and 1 thing that you taste. Okay, so that is 5-4-3-2-1 method. Then we have body scan. What is body scan? We need to take break and scan our body completely, mindfully. That is, you have to be very aware of your body. You have to see your posture, you have to see where your hand is placed, you have to see where your foot is placed, is it touching the ground, or how you are sitting. You will become aware of your posture as you play. And the last one is ABC room. ABC room is, you are sitting in a room and you will be in online learning, teaching techniques or online gaming. You have a break and find out the things that are in the room starting with letter A, B and C. You give a break. Okay, you take time and you give a break. And finally, you have other activities. Lot of other activities other than gaming you can involve in, like painting, okay, you can involve in word searching, you can involve yourself in dancing, which is a very good exercise, and you can involve in doing craft, okay, you can involve in lot of puzzle games and also in slimy. We get that slimy kits now, so kids can be introduced to these different things along with outdoor and indoor games. So that we don't, I'm not telling again I repeat, it's my, I'm not telling you to stop playing online game, but you need to have control, okay, and you can involve in other activities. So that's all. Thank you, students, and thank you, Sports Council Mahe and the Department of Physical Education, for giving me this opportunity.
As a matter of gratitude, I would like to thank Pro Chancellor, Vice Chancellor, Pro Vice Chancellor and Registrar of Manipal Academy of Higher Education for the motivation and guidance. A huge thanks to speakers for their valuable discussion. A wholehearted thanks to all the participants from across the globe. A gratitude goes to Assistant Director, IT and the Audiovisual Department. Special thanks to Mr. Chetan and Mr. Umesh for the technical coordination. Finally, a shout out to the members and all my friends from the Sports Council, the Secretary, Physical Directors from Department of Physical Education, students, faculties, HOIs and university officials for their support. Stay at home, stay safe, have a good day. Thank you.